Why don't we just ask Dr. Webster Tarpley, because he's here on the line now. Sorry about the confusion getting started, Webster, but welcome back to INN World Report
Hello,
Radio.
How are you? Good to see you.
Well, we're good. I just was chatting with the audience about these real-world exercises that seem to, you know, hang around like Karen birds whenever there's a disaster or a terrorist attack. It seems like there's always these real-world exercises going on at the same time. And isn't that a possible cover when people say, well, if people were in on this, somebody would have talked. Isn't it possible that lots of people were in on it and they didn't know it? They thought they were in on an exercise and then suddenly it gets switched live?
It certainly is the case that many of the lower-level and middle-level people who participate in these actions don't know what they're doing. There is sometimes a concern after the fact that they may figure out what they have done, and that leads sometimes to these people being eliminated. I think you can make a case that some of the people who set up certain aspects of 9/11 were invited to a meeting on the 88th floor of the North Tower on the morning of 9/11, so that they could meet their fate, which was to get killed. But I think in general, the thing I would stress again and again about 9/11 is we're now in the midst of this orgy of maudlin sentimentality and distortion. I heard the press conference of the members, or at least most of the members of the Kane-Hamilton Commission, where they simply lie with breathtaking cynicism, and they don't mention anything about what Hamilton and Governor Kane of New Jersey had written about in their book. Remember, without precedent, on the, I guess it was the fifth anniversary of the events in August of 2006, they said the top generals of the United States Air Force engaged in massive perjury, and we wondered what to do. And what they decided to do was not to do what would have been legal if they were concerned about the credibility of their silly commission. That would have been to send criminal referrals for perjury to the Department of Justice. Instead, they said, no, we'll just ask the Inspector General of the Pentagon to see what he thinks. And of course, that led to nothing, that he found no irregularities, because that was an in-house investigation. And the coup was centered to a very large degree in the Pentagon and an even larger degree in the Air Force, maybe somewhat less in the land army, as far as one can see. But the basic idea is that drills, exercises, war games, operations, and even just activities of the Defense Department in particular, but also of other agencies, are used to conduit and bootleg false flag terrorist operations. And this is, it's basically a universal principle, and it should be recognized. Just a couple of examples. In my book, George H.W. Bush, The Unauthorized Biography, we found that on the day when Reagan was shot, allegedly by Hinckley, say by Hinckley et al., in 1981, the White House was in the middle of a presidential succession drill, a nine lives drill. And the
you got to be kidding! I didn't know about that one. That's pretty hairy, isn't it?
Yeah, and this is, of course, this is one of the most ignored ones, and it's one of the most outrageous, because you also had, of course, Neil Bush meeting with Scott Hinckley. In other words, the president's son, his ne'er-do-well son, Neil Bush, was meeting with the would-be assassin's older brother. And what were they talking about? They were scheduled to meet on the day after the shooting actually took place, and that was suppressed.
Yeah,
and
for a moment, you stir up some fascinating memories. I'm thinking of Alexander Haig saying, "I'm in charge." You know, maybe he didn't know it was an that maybe he thought it was the exercise, right? Alexander Haig. Then you also have this strange relationship between the Bushes and the Hinckleys, right?
Yeah, they're close family friends, and this then came out. It was an AP wire, and they were, if you read again in my book, George Bush, The Unauthorized Biography, there were press conferences held by Vice President George Bush, by Neil Bush, Rocky Mountain News, now defunct, but there it is. It's in that book. And they all basically say, oh, it's just a weird happenstance. It's just, you know, one of those amazing coincidences in life. And, of course, the thing with Haig was the entire CIA faction went bonkers because they didn't want Haig saying he was in charge. They used that very cynically to discredit Haig. And anybody who jumped on that Let's Get Al Haig bandwagon is prima facie suspect of working for the CIA, because that was an attempted coup. And it really was a coup, because at that point, Bush the elder, Vice President Bush, took over the federal government and never really released his hold. He became the czar of all covert operations of the United States and ran every phase of Iran-Contra from beginning to end, through Oliver North, Felix Rodriguez, and a whole bunch of other people. Anyway, just the drill is what interests me here and now. Another example, we're just finding with Breivik, right? Anders Breivik of Norway, the Oslo shooter, right? He goes on a murder spree in the capital, Oslo, and then also on this summer vacation island of the youth division of the ruling Labor Party, I guess it is. And what do we find there? It had been known that a bomb drill in the capital, in this area of the prime minister's office, had been held within about a year to a year and a half earlier, before this happened. But now we know that on that same Friday, there was a drill run by the police and the security forces in the center of Oslo, right at the same point, right by the prime minister's office, the foreign ministry, and other important government offices. It was a bomb drill carried out by the police and the security forces, and the real bomb went off less than an hour, and according to some accounts, less than half an hour after the drill ended. So one can imagine, if you want to defeat the security near the prime minister's office, organize a legally sanctioned anti-terror drill, except when you bring in the props, right, you bring in whatever the bomb is supposed to be, bring in more than one, and bring in a real bomb, and arrange to leave that behind when the police go home after the end of the drill, and then that explodes, and that sets off the entire thing. And this Breivik is turning out to be a massive complicity of the police with the shooter. And of course, what has disappeared from that narrative is the telltale second shooter, whose presence is attested to by eyewitnesses.
And then, of course, you've got all the 7/7 coincidental drills as well,
yes,
which we'll get into right on the other side of this break. Friends, we're speaking with Webster G. Tarpley, Dr. Webster G. Tarpley, and we're talking about the kinds of events that 9/11 was and the uncanny amount of drills and so forth that seem to be running at the same time. We'll be right back with Dr. Tarpley right after this. All right, good friends. Welcome back. Tom Kiley here, INN World Report Radio. We're speaking with Dr. Webster Tarpley, tarpley.net. Webster, that's the best place for people to catch up with you and all your writings?
Well, I would recommend right now, especially if you're interested in the fifth edition of my book, 9/11 Synthetic Terror Made in USA. If you want to get the fifth edition, which now brings the drill count up to 46 9/11 drills, about half of them in preparation, concentrated in the years from really about 1999 to 2001, the 2 years before, and the about a half of them taking place on 9/11, making 9/11 the densest drill day in U.S. history, as far as I've been able to determine. To get all of that, the best thing to do is to send an email to info@progressivepress.com, info, I-N-F-O, like information, at progressivepress.com, or you can go to the website progressivepress.com in Southern California, and you can order the fifth edition there more easily than any place else, better than Amazon at this point.
Well, you know what, Webster, we will get back to the specifics of that day, but I think you've been giving people a valuable background when you're talking about the nature of these false flag operations and the telltale signs of training exercises that are going on at the same time. I didn't even know about that continuity of government with Reagan, and of course I knew from your work about all the stuff that was going on 9/11, and now it's emerging in Norway. But anything you could tell us about what happened in Spain? Was there that same thing going on? And B, the big rotten stinking fish in the middle of that 7/7 attack in London, right?
Well, the London one is notorious, of course, because as everybody by now should know, you had Peter Power of Visor Associates going on BBC television that night and saying, "Oh my heavens, We the Visor Associates, is acting as a subcontractor for somebody he wouldn't name, was holding bomb drills in pretty much those stations at pretty much those times on that July 7th of 2005. And it's amazing that he's never been hauled in front of some kind of a serious grand jury. But as far as I know, he goes on television now as a terrorist, anti-terrorist expert. The Spanish one, I think we can leave aside for the moment, but the general principle, I think, is clear enough. The bombing of Libya is a drill gone live. That's another way you can do it. You schedule a military drill. This is typically, you know, country A wants to invade country B. They deploy their army along the border of country B. They put out a release saying, oh, this is just summer maneuvers. This is just
Nazis tried that with Poland or something, didn't they?
Well, this is actually what this is what Stalin did in May and June of 1941, when it looks like Stalin was getting ready to launch his own attack, and Hitler beat him to the draw. That's the story of June 21st, 22nd, 1941. But in terms of Libya. This is, of course, Operation South Mistral, otherwise known as Operation Harmattan, which is the name of the same wind, depending on which side of the Mediterranean you're on. And it was a secret agreement of London and Paris signed on November 2nd of 2010, saying that the French and the British would hold the exercise, Operation South Mistral, and that would be the bombing of a North African country. So that was a drill when it started, and they
drilled. Actually, Webster, point of order, you're saying what, December of 2010?
November 2nd.
November. Now, isn't this before the so-called Arab Spring reared its head?
But it's the Arab Spring is, of course, a cynically planned destabilization of all of these countries. There's nothing authentic in it, except, I guess, the authentic fact that a lot of people were duped. But you can look at Tunisia, you can look at Egypt, certainly Libya, certainly Syria. These places are all much worse off than they were because they've exchanged a fairly, well, predictable kind of authoritarian government for something which now goes in the direction of chaos. Just from today, we have an Al-Qaeda boss in Libya, a guy called Salabi, who's a notorious Al-Qaeda killer. And he says that the civilians at the top of the transitional council, the Benghazi rebel congeries, whatever they call this thing, mainly Jalil and Jibril, who are both veterans of Gaddafi governments, Salabi from Al-Qaeda wants them both out. And Salabi is the head of the February 17th Martyrs Brigade, and they're responsible, by all accounts, for the assassination of Yunus, the other ex-Gaddafi guy who was prominent in the Benghazi rebel council. So Libya is headed into another phase of civil war, whatever else happens. And in Egypt, you've exchanged the military dictatorship of Mubarak, who, at least was a known quantity, to now the military dictatorship of a much weaker person by the name of Tantawi. Similarly, in Tunisia, when I passed through there, the big thing is that the Muslim Brotherhood is getting ready to take over Tunisia. And this is a tragedy because Tunisia is one of the most secular, most Frenchified, most westernized, most pro-European places in North Africa. But one or two more of these cases. Did we go through the question of the plot to kill Hitler from this point of view?
No, we did not. About a planned exercise and so
let's
forth.
Go through it. No, this is the same thing.
Sure.
In the case now, this is now 1943, 1944 in Germany. Now, the thing that I'm getting at here is that if you want to conduct an operation, if you want to pull a coup, right, because that's what 9/11 is. 9/11 is a coup d'etat. It's a putsch by generals. They cannot do this openly for many, many reasons. They need government resources to carry it out. They must have access to government resources, but at the same time, they've got to keep secret the fact that they're using these government resources. So the way you do that is you pick a drill and you make changes in the drill. Sometimes they seem to be small changes, but they simply involve going from pretend to real, from pretend killing to real killing. You can then bootleg or conduit or channel or conduct the terrorist action, the false flag, through the drill. Now, we're accustomed to thinking of the people who are doing the false flag are the bad guys, and the public in general would be against them. And I think in most cases that's true. There are also a lot of people in these bureaucracies who would be against them. So they've got to keep it secret. They've got to have a way to exclude all sorts of people who may be loyal, may be patriotic, may not be part of the putsch for other reasons. Right? Maybe they hate the people that are doing the putsch. They don't want to have the other people get promoted over them. Many, many reasons. So in the stuff we're familiar with, you conduit it through the apparatus for evil reasons. But now let's take an example of some people who are trying to do something good on the whole, which is to kill Hitler and end the Nazi regime. Certainly good. So what do they do? Their problem is similar in the sense that they're surrounded now by the Gestapo and the SS, who are ferociously loyal to Hitler, and the plotters are in the army, right? You could say 9/11, you could say looks like an Air Force coup. In the Hitler case, it's the army trying to overthrow him.
Well, they made a movie out of it, Valkyrie, recently. Yeah, but let's talk about that on the other side of the break, Webster, because the music is coming up. We're speaking with Webster G. Tarpley, tarpley.net, all the latest information that he digs up. And then, of course, is the latest version of his book is there, too. And Webster will be here in New York with us at INN Sunday afternoon, September the 11th. Friends, welcome back. Tom Kiley here, INN World Report Radio. Always lots of information from our guest, Webster Tarpley. Very, very prolific, I must say, Webster. I don't know how you do it. You seem like the ever-ready bunny to me. You know, you're always working, you're always passionate, you're always full of information, and I love the way you also tie it in historically to other things. We're talking about this phenomena of when you want to do a coup, when you want to do a false flag operation, very good cover sometimes is to have a drill going on that's very similar to the event that ends up taking place. And you were talking historically about some other examples of it.
Right. And again, we have the attempted assassination of Reagan, making Bush, CIA Bush, the head of the country. That was under a drill. The bombing of Libya is a drill. Breivik in Norway is a drill. London 7/7/2005 is a drill, and on and on. And the example of the plot to kill Hitler, I think, is useful because it shows that this is not limited to the U.S. It's not limited in time or space. This is how things are done. And people have got to get used to this fact. And for the left liberal mind, I know this is really hard for people. They can't seem to accept this. I'm noticing old Noam Chomsky popping off again about 9/11, right? Was there some way to avoid the Afghan war after 9/11? Yeah, Noam, it would have been for you, Noam, and Amy Goodman, and a bunch of other people to come out and say, the government story on 9/11 is a racist, fascist, militarist myth, and we will not have anything to do with it. We condemn it. It's full of holes. We will not be governed by it, and we urge all persons to do the same thing. Of course, that's exactly what he doesn't do. But just to get back now to the question of Operation Valkyrie. So here we are. We have some German colonels and generals who want to get rid of Hitler, and they want to get rid of the Nazi regime, and they want to get rid of the SS and the Gestapo in particular. So what they do is they look around and they find not exactly a drill, but an operation, and it's an operation that's connected to drills, because the way you train for things in the military is through drills, and this is what the military does all the time. It's a grave danger. So they find this Operation Valkyrie. So what is that? Operation Valkyrie is the mobilization of the home army, the reserve army. In other words, military units that are not good enough for active duty service in the front lines, but they can still do a lot. They may be people who are semi-invalid or a little bit too old, or a little bit too young, or whatever it is. So there is this home army or reserve army. So the goal of Valkyrie, as originally written, is to mobilize the home army against an Allied parachute drop, right? drop a parachute division into Berlin and create chaos, who's going to fight that? Well, the Home Army, the Reserve Army, and or an uprising, a mass rebellion of the slave laborers in the factories, not all of them in concentration camps, some of them in concentration camps, some of them not. In the original Valkyrie, the SS and the Gestapo play a key role. So what Tom Cruise, Klaus Schenk von Stauffenberg, does in the actual history is he gets together with Treskow and Quirnheim, and they rewrite the Valkyrie to exclude the SS and the Gestapo. Indeed, the new form of it says the army can arrest the SS and the Gestapo, because it may be that the SS and the Gestapo are trying to have a coup d'etat, presumably after Hitler has left the scene, after he's been killed. And you, in the movie, Tom, if you've seen it, you remember this scene at night in the park, in the Grunewald in Berlin. They've got an oil lamp, and they've got his secretary, Fräulein von Ofen, and he's there with Treskow and Tom Cruise, and they're rewriting Valkyrie in the park at night in the middle of an air raid, right? And then, this is actually very well done in this movie. I would urge people to see it. It was just on American Movie Channel this past Sunday. I was able to see it again. There's another scene where they get it approved by Hitler. So they go to the Berghof, right? They go to...
Right, and there was this kind of tense moment. Would he sign it or not?
It's amazing because you got all the Nazi bigwigs in the room. You've got Goebbels, you've got Goering, you've got Himmler, the most sinister of all. You've got the whole bunch. And Keitel, right? Keitel is the military head that all the other generals hate because he's a yes man for Hitler, and he treats them brutally. So we have the head of the Home Army brings Tom Cruise, Stauffenberg, who's the chief of staff of the Home Army, and he's got the changes, so they got to put it under Hitler's nose and get him to sign it. So this takes
knowing that he's not going to have the time to read it, right?
He's not going to have time to read it, and Hitler gets hung up on, oh, Valkyrie, that's Wagnerian, right? That's one of the ring cycle, of course, the goddesses that see who's going to die and who's going to live on the battlefield. So he gets Hitler to approve the changes.
Right.
Now this, I think it's a good way to see how you do it. In other words, you take Amalgam Virgo 01. What's Amalgam Virgo 01? Well, you're going to be firing a cruise missile from a barge or a boat, a rogue freighter, or you're going to be firing an unmanned aerial vehicle from a barge or a freighter, and you're going to hit a target on the land. So why don't we just make some small changes? You can say, let's change it so instead of having a pretend drone aircraft, we can have a real one. And instead of pretend launch, we'll have a real launch with real explosives, and the target is the Pentagon. I think the evidence is overwhelming that this is what hit the Pentagon. And then you have, let's take an example here. You mentioned continuity of government. Positive Force 01, that's April 2001, but the capabilities remain. This is a continuity of government exercise that involves a terrorist group hijacking a commercial airliner and flying it into the Pentagon. And that sounds pretty much like what happened, except for the commercial airliner that never got there. But that's close enough, and it brings in this continuity of government. And when you see,
and of course, that also puts the lie to Condoleezza Rice, you know, with her crocodile tears on TV, saying, who could have imagined an airliner hitting the Pentagon?
Let me just, since we're on that, let me just go through some of this. This had been drilled over a 10-year period. In 1991 already, NORAD is drilling foreign hijacked airliner crashing into famous U.S. building. 1998, Richard Clark in the Clinton White House. Terrorists load a Learjet with explosives and attack some building in Washington, D.C. NORAD, hijacked aircraft, hit many targets, mass casualty drill. Then we have NORAD, October 2000. Terrorist crashes Federal Express plane into UN headquarters, New York. Then a week later, terrorist crashes FedEx plane with weapons of mass destruction into UN. Pentagon exercise, October 2000. Commercial aircraft hits the Pentagon. FAA, December 2000. Charter flight out of Ohio turns off its transponder, right? The whole transponder story plays a big role in it. So you get the idea. She's absolutely talking through her hat. I mean, this is a barefaced, outrageous, bombastic lie. And if she ever said that in front of a congressional committee under oath, that's perjury. But of course, as Kane and Hamilton show us, perjury doesn't matter when it's a question of defending this this bankrupt oligarchy, idiotic ruling class that we have.
The demons avoid that Bible and going under oath like vampires avoid the light, don't they? They want to squirm and wiggle and do anything they can to not be under oath, right?
I wouldn't overestimate it, though, because I remember the, you know, this 9/11 Citizens Watch, these two characters. They did this big thing. They got some money. They put ads in the Washington, D.C. subway. Cheney, Bush, and Condoleezza have to testify in public under oath. Big deal. They're going to lie, and nothing's going to happen. Again, we know that the top U.S. Air Force generals, including the top commanders of the North American Air Defense Command and the Northeast Air Defense Sector, committed perjury, or to the extent that they were asked anything at all. And nothing happened. And Kane and Hamilton published a book. I'm sure you know this, right? They published a book saying there was massive perjury by these generals. So it just doesn't seem to matter, right?
Kane and Hamilton were chosen because I think in the modeling of their personalities, it was known that they wouldn't do anything about it.
And of course, Henry Kissinger was first choice. So if Henry Kissinger is first choice, then you know what it is. Maybe the other thing about this, I don't know if we've gone through this, but in terms of the drills that you find, that I found, the 46 of them, there is this overarching question of world politics in the following sense. The 9/11 action is designed to promote the war of civilizations as developed by Samuel Huntington and indeed his friends. Zbigniew Brzezinski must have had a hand in this too, right? Brzezinski came out with his own book about the importance of Central Asia, right? The great chessboard. So if the goal of 9/11, and we know this from another drill, we know that the goal is the invasion of Afghanistan, Pakistan. And the drill for this one is Unified Vision 01.
Why don't we have a unified break for 1 second, okay. Webster, because I don't want you to have to stop in the middle of that.
Sure.
We're speaking with Webster Griffin Tarpley. We'll be right back with him right after this break. All right, good friends, welcome back. As part of our run-up to the 10th anniversary on Sunday of the tragic events of September 11th, which hit us here in New York particularly hard, just 1/2 mile directly north of Ground Zero at INN Studios on Sunday afternoon, the 11th of September, we'll be having another seminar, not quite like the 3-day seminar that we had last year, but Webster Griffin Tarpley, our guest, will be one of the speakers. You can go to innworldreport.net to find all about that if you're in town, and we'll be producing a DVD of it as well. Webster, back to what you were saying before. Before you continue, can I just make a point of order here for those who may not be familiar with the mechanics of a coup d'etat? But basically, as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, because you certainly know a lot more about this than I do, the mechanics are such that you want to take advantage of the existing bureaucracy, which is just looking upward and looking to take orders from what they believe is whoever is in charge, as legitimately in charge as possible. And I think in this film that you point out, in the Valkyrie, for instance, there were people who were involved in the, you know, securing of the city of Berlin and so forth, who seemed like they were pretty loyal to Adolf Hitler. But as long as you showed them these papers that were signed by Hitler that said, here's Operation Valkyrie, do what's in the papers, they were willing to go ahead and act against their own interests. Is that fair to say?
They were covered. For the question of the coup d'etat is basically when one part of a government attacks another part and asserts its supremacy over the entire government. And that would be, it's written up by Curzio Malaparte, Malaparte, does one about Mussolini's march on Rome and the Kapp-Putsch in Berlin. This is an attempt by monarchists to seize control of Germany and 1920, the beginning of the Weimar Republic. Edward Luttwak, sort of a neocon, takes this a little bit further into the sort of post-World War II space. But it's a putsch. In other words, it's a group of generals and high government officials who want to assert their control over the entire government. They want to change the course of the government. And remember, this asinine stuff about Bush and Cheney, the masterminds of 9/11, this is absolutely ridiculous, right? Bush, on the face of it, a moron. Cheney, equally, he's the spokesman for a group that tells him what to do. He's not deciding anything. He can't run anything. Who in his right mind would take some guy with 4 to 5 heart attacks and 3 pacemakers and God knows what else and say, we're taking this entire thing and putting it in your hands and, you know, keep an eye on your blood pressure during this, because, you know, if you croak in the middle of it, then we're all up the creek. So it's impossible, right? And I think this is one thing that people should see by now, right? By now you should have learned. Bush, Cheney, and the neocons have been out of power for quite a while, and the false flag continues. False flags continue. It cannot have been them. It is this deeper problem, the rogue network, the invisible government, parallel government, deep state, secret government, whatever you want to call it.
You know, Webster, on that point, really briefly, I think that was the reason behind the theft of the 2000 election, because those planning 9/11 knew that Cheney and Bush would be much better cover and spokespeople for this and more easily manipulated than Al Gore.
I think Al Gore, if you look at Al Gore, was eager to surrender to Bush. Al Gore couldn't concede that election fast enough. I think
true
he was
that.
A pathetic specimen, and he would have followed orders with equal servitude and equal degradation. But let me just go back to the really scary part that a lot of people still are not aware of. Right? You've got in the middle of it all, there's this Angel Is Next, right? Angel Is Next comes down to Air Force One, and it basically says, we're the coup, and we're going to shoot down the president's plane if we don't get what we want. And it's clear what they want. They want the war of civilizations. They want somebody to go on television and start saying, Bin Laden, Bin Laden, Bin Laden, Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda. That's what Richard Clark had been telling his CNN and CBS contacts, the same thing all day long. So, again, Bush is an expendable asset in the middle of this. But
can you clarify that? Angel Is Next? That's another
Angel
operation?
Angel Is Next is the Air Force One, and it comes in loaded with codes that cut across the main power agencies of the U.S. government, CIA, DIA, NSA, Pentagon, and so forth, right? The power agencies, the ones that can exert military armed force. So it's a threat to Bush, and he's getting these reports that airplanes are coming to crash into Air Force One. He's not sure whether he has an Air Force escort. He's not sure whether the Air Force escort is friendly or hostile. When he takes off, he doesn't have one. He gets it. But then he wonders whether that was good or not. It's all in my book, and it's incredible because most people ignore this stuff, whereas this is absolutely critical
stuff. There's even what looks like a kind of half-hearted assassination attempt against Bush at Longboat Key in the morning. And if you don't know about that one, read my book. But to get to the really scary part, Unified Vision 01 of May 2001 is the Joint Forces Command, the Central Command, and the Special Operations Command with 40 other agencies. So this is the invasion of Afghanistan and Pakistan, because they're invaded too. Pakistan gets an ultimatum from Richard Armitage: if you don't give us flyover rights and transit rights, we'll bomb you back into the Stone Age. That's where the Pakistan story started. The Pakistanis never asked for the U.S., believe me. They had to be forced into it at gunpoint. So Afghanistan and Pakistan are coming. But now here's the problem. There is Russia, right? That used to be the Soviet Union. They spent 10 years and 20 or 30,000 dead securing this place as somehow neutral, not occupied by the U.S. Now, at the middle of 9/11, Bush is essentially going to say to Putin, guess what? We're seizing Afghanistan. What if Putin says, the hell you are, I'll blow your head off. Don't you dare. I'm not impressed by your dog and pony show, and Russia's national interests don't change. If you want to blow up your own buildings, this doesn't concern us in the least. So in order to prepare for that, what do you have to have? You've got to essentially go to nuclear alert, and that's what they did. They go to what amounts to a red alert, Cuban Missile Crisis level. This is Global Guardian of Strategic Stratcom, Offutt, Barksdale, Minot, Whiteman, the four main bases. And this is an Armageddon drill.
General Ivashov of Moscow, who was commanding in Moscow that day, has told me, on the morning of 9/11, before any planes were hijacked, we saw the B-52s in the air, the submarines were in position, and it looked like the missiles, that the Minutemen and so forth, were ready to go. This is combined with Amalgam Warrior, Crown Vigilance, of which nothing is known, that's Air Combat Command, and Apollo Guardian of the U.S. Space Command, where no details of that are known either. So
now this obviously is a fairly rare occurrence. You mentioned the Cuban Missile Crisis. Is there any indication how often this kind of brinksmanship has happened?
Red Alert would be, the Kippur War in 1973. Kissinger went to Red Alert. The U.S. got to some kind of an alert during this Operation Able Archer in 1983. It's a rare event. And then there's something even more. Suppose the U.S. rogue network tries this bluff. We're going to seize Afghanistan and Pakistan and, you know, some other places in Central Asia. They seized quite a few in the five republics. Suppose the Russians hang tough and they say, yeah, we see your B-52s. Well, we have some pretty good missiles ourselves. You want to see some coming down your stovepipe here? In this case, how would you launch? Do they have a way to launch? Does the rogue network actually control nuclear missiles, right? Ordering a drill, they can do.
Fascinating. They were transferring that authority during this whole thing?
Yes, and here's what it is. This is the Global Guardian computer network attack, which I've written up in this chapter. Enemy forces, first of all, war dial the STRATCOM telephone and fax systems, and that's the outside attack. In the inside, there's a bad insider who has access to the key command, control, and communication system, meaning missile launch. So we have a pretend bad insider who can access a command system, meaning command means you can launch a missile. Suppose this drill goes live. Suppose the pretend bad insider becomes a real bad insider and decides to launch. We do have the doomsday aircraft are in the air. We have three E-4B National Airborne Operations Center planes, complete with looking glass communications. And we've got Brent Scowcroft on one of these planes. We've also got Warren Buffett at Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska, where Bush is going to arrive later in the day. Suppose on the day of 9/11, Bush and Cheney both fall by the wayside. What's the government? Well, maybe this is the government. Maybe they're going to go for a committee of public safety with Brent Scowcroft and Gray Eminence of the establishment, let's say, and then Warren Buffett, right, a business leader. And maybe they build around that a committee of people. Because remember, Moscow 10 years before, just about exactly 10 years before, right, the August coup in Moscow was a committee of nine, committee of public safety. The GPCK, and in the case of the United States, it might have been something looking kind of similar. So this is much neglected, and it just shows the tremendous poverty of 9/11 research, right?
I think it shows the poverty of the research and the media in our country. But thanks to you coming on this show and other venues, it's fascinating to me, and I'm jumping in, Webster, because we're sadly out of time. I'd offer you another hour next Thursday, this Thursday, if you have it. I could check your schedule because this is amazing. And I know you're going to be talking about this here in New York this weekend too, right?
Yeah, let's see what we can do. Why don't you send me an email? But again, info@progressivepress.com or go to the progressivepress.com website and order it direct from them. And make sure you get the fifth edition because that's got the 46 drills.
Well, Webster, I'll make it a point on this show when the book is available. We'll do our part to help sell it. And I know you're bringing copies here to New York with you as well.
Yeah, and don't wait. I mean, get the word out because the other thing we ought to mention is, you know, the autumn, this things are looking like there might be another false flag in the offing, right, for a number of reasons that we could go through. Maybe Thursday is a good idea.
Very good, because we are overdue. All right, thank you very much, Webster Griffin Tarpley, tarpley.net. Friends, that's it. We'll be back on Thursday with more 9/11 for you on the 10th anniversary.